and welcome to the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. You know what? No, you're thinking, Billy, why do you sound a bit glum here? It's a great day. You're going to go see some wrestling. That's the best thing ever, right? And you're right. It is a great thing. We're going to go see some wrestling. I'm going to talk about it for a little bit. But this isn't the first time I've recorded this bit today. This is not the first time I've recorded it. Because, well, no, actually, I'll take that back. It is the first time I've recorded it. Because I'm in Huntley now. And usually I do the opening bit of the podcast when I'm doing road trips to Aberdeen. I do that during my house to about Keith, right about there. That's when I do the opening segment. That's about 20 minutes, half an hour-ish, you know? And that was what I thought I did. And I'm trying to get my window wipers going, and that's not going well for me either today. So, I recorded 3 minutes worth, and then I had my phone kind of propped over there, you know, I had it in the door handle area, which, you know, was a great idea in my head, and it just worked, because I used it before. To get to Huntley for the W3L Wrestling Showdown 2 episode, where I did that big intro because I knew I was only got like a 5 minute journey to the actual venue, right? So I did that. 3 minutes in, my phone fell off the side. So, alright, bugger, you know? I might put that as the outtake at the end. You might get the 3 minutes that I did record before my phone fell over. And from that point onwards, right, I thought, okay. I held it for a bit, so I literally had it in front of my face for a good 10 minutes while I recorded a little bit. I thought, no, I'm driving, that's not safe, I'll put it back there and see if that holds for a little bit longer. Because Elgin Keith got quite a few roundabouts, so it's a bit of a shitbag for that. So I did that, ace, I thought, half an hour passes, 35 minute passes, 40 minute passes, I'm past Keith, on my way to Huntley. Great, I've previewed the show, there was an ambulance at one point going past, you got to hear my squeaky window wipers, which is what you got to hear now, so you still get that, and then I stop at Huntley, get some fuel, go for a pee, pick up some supplies, got Dr. Pepper, got a Monster, got a Salvage. Go to check how long it's recorded for, because you know, it's a big chunk of time in this episode. I recorded 3 minutes and 21 seconds, because I turned off, the video stopped recording, and my phone fell off the side of my door here. So, I still filled in the time anyway, but I wasted possible gems of puns, of Christmas puns, because because I wasn't recording it, and I can't remember anything that I said. So there was a point where I missed a match, I forgot what match was, I then remembered the match, and then I went on to speak about another match, and I still forgot about the match, I had to go back again. You know what, it was a whole thing. So I'm having a wee rant to start off this particular episode before I do it all over again. Because it's still only 2:15, so I have loads of time between now and the show actually beginning to get to Dainston Community Centre for the show thing. So with that, yes, we're back. Number 7 in our on-tour, the actual on-tour episodes. A season where I thought it would just be like on-tour episodes that every couple of weeks I've thrown in an interview for shits and giggles. But I think I've ended the season on about 30-ish episodes. Because the on-location ones who are separately, they're kind of like bonus stuff. They don't class as actual episodes. I think I ended about 30 episodes. And only 7 of which will be actual on-tour. The rest will be on-location or pit stops. We've got a detour in there as well. And we may even have a holiday episode, possibly. We have plans. I have plans for a holiday episode that will play on Christmas Day, and it'll be a year-end award, kind of year-end review / year-end award preview. More news on that probably by the time this episode actually goes out. on Friday. I'm still gutted that I've missed that you didn't get 30 minutes of my time. So I will very occasionally look at my phone just to make sure that it's still recording. And hopefully you'll see me, because what I've done is, with my ingenuity, is you can just about see me, mostly just see the top of my car here. But I have taken the tripod that I didn't plan really to take today, because I haven't asked any permission to do any pre-show stuff with the guys at WrestleZone today. So I didn't plan to take it. But what I've done is I have loaded it, I've loaded my phone onto it, and I've kept the end like non-tripod-y, so it's just like a selfie stick, and I have jabbed the bastard into the chair, into the bastard side chair, so it should move, but it may move. It probably will move in the next wee while. Anyway, so I don't know how long this preview's going to be, because I probably need to get my full camera out the map suit at some point to find my way to Deanston. Again, loads of time, so I might stop at Inverurie to finish up if I need to do so. Anyway, let's look at the show. So I'm looking forward to this one. It's Christmas Chaos, WrestleZone Christmas Chaos, at Deanston Community Centre. Venue I've been to already this year for the Anarchy. It's a really nice venue. It's quite open plan, open, it's spacious. It's a good size venue for wrestling. You get a good view regardless of where you sit. And I'm really looking forward to this one. I missed Halloween hijinks because initially Storm Babette postponed the show. I think it was October 16th or something it was supposed to be on, and then I got pushed to 2 weeks later to November 4th. However, I was already busy that day for doing actual grown-up things, getting some Christmas photos done, which looked phenomenal. It was totally worth it. And Elgin were doing their fireworks that day, that evening, which it was that evening. I can find a poster, I can prove it. We're going to take Jack to that. Ended up, it got really, really cold, so we didn't really want to take him out to that, just in case he didn't like it. And then we're in a cold place where he's not enjoying it, and he's right about his bedtime anyway. He's a really good sleeper, so we kind of wanted to keep him on his general bedtime. Anyway, so I ended up just ordering WWE Network and watching whatever it was, Crown Jewel, whatever. And we could see most of the fireworks from our front door anyway, so we were able to hold Jack and he could have a look, and he was fascinated. He loved them. His eyes widened in. He was mesmerised by them. So in retrospect, probably should have went, because I think he would have really loved them, but we got to see a lot of them anyway, and he loved them, and we were in a nice warm house, and we got to, Sandy was fine, our dog. She's not so fussed about the sound of fireworks, it's when she can see them. I don't know why it freaks her out, but I don't know why the noise doesn't freak her out, but the seeing the fireworks does. But that's just how Sandy rolls. So we got to stay home with her as well, because she wasn't enjoying it, because of the flashes and all that kind of stuff. So I'm going to see Craig Joe, which was pretty good. I ordered it on the absolute certainty that Drew was winning the World Heavyweight Championship, because I believe the dirt sheets, the bastards on the internet, I believe them, I believe the hype, and sometimes that works, because I stayed up to watch Survivor Series, and I got to see Randy Orton return and CM Punk come out after the wee watermark thing. So sometimes it works out, sometimes it doesn't. I've watched two shows for my $9.99, which is why I cancelled my WWE Network, and I will restart it again middle of January in time for the Royal Rumble. So I'm still gonna get my money eventually, because I might as well keep it for WrestleMania at that point, silly not to. So we got that. Missed Halloween hijinks, because the Stonehaven date wasn't good that anyway. And now here we are, December 2nd, 2023, Christmas Chaos, Deanston Community Centre, on a show that's sold out. So I did a Wrestle podcast for a show that's sold out, I don't know why, since I started doing that podcast, I'm not saying it's the reason, since I started doing that podcast, every show is sold out. So, it's made the podcast feel kind of pointless, because I'm previewing a show that's sold out, so I'm not selling any tickets to a show, I'm not saying, oh, you should come along, because you can't, because there's no tickets left, you know? So, I know that if anyone's watched the latest Mickey's Mosh Pit with Omar Mohammed, I know Omar's kind of the reason for all the sellouts. Ronan King thinks he's the reason for all the sellouts as well. But yeah, I'm just saying, this year anyway, I think we've previewed every show, and every show's sold out, either as of or just after the podcast goes out. So I'm just saying. I'm taking no responsibility or anything for that, because WrestleZone have been fantastic this year, or fantastic last year. They've been great since the return of the shows, as I've said numerous times in many places, because they've just been consistently great, entertaining shows. I'm going to try my wipers again. They've frozen. The scooters have frozen. It's frozen. I filled it up, so definitely they've got full, so we'll see if it works. Ah, come on, you pricks, I want to see. There we go. Hey, let there be scoosh. Sweet. Right. Well, let that side go. Anyway, so we've got six matches plus the VIP pre-show match. I'm wearing sunglasses because even though it is -2 degrees right now, the sun is really low. And so I'm not just like trying to look cool for the podcast. I can't look cool on the podcast when I spend the first 5 minutes raging because I just talked about stuff and didn't record any of it. So I can't really look cool in that respect. Either you can just about see my head now as I'm looking back to make sure it's still recording. Still recording. Can I move it? I'm too scared to record. I'm still going to move. Hang on. Hello! You can see my shoulder now. Sexy. So we're just coming up to infinity. That's the turn-off to everybody anyway, or a turn-off. We'll pass Colpe and Jericho, signed to Jericho. So yeah, six matches, one VIP ticket holder match. I'm going to go through them, I'm going to talk about them, I'm going to go, that's going to be ace, Ben, ace, it's going to be cool, good show, Ken. Hi, Ken. As I do. So we'll start with the VIP pre-show. I really hunched there, so I can get a lot of poop. Boot here, sorry. Anyway, so VIP pre-show, ticket holder match, you pay £3 extra, you get to watch an extra match. Bargain, right? Bargain. You pretty much get a free match, you know, because we get two free matches, because £15, if we talk about £3 a match, that works out at 5 matches. So there's 7 matches on the show in total if you get a VIP ticket. So you get 2 free matches here, you know, for that extra £3. It's maths, right? We've got Oliver Green against Chris Archer, singles match, VIP ticket holder. Ollie Green got a win at Halloween Hijinks, didn't see it, I assume it was good. So he's on a high here, he's got his first win in WrestleZone. On main shows, could have got a win on gala shows, I have no idea. So he's riding high here. He's against Chris Archer, his first singles match since Army Anarchy, when he lost to Mickey Vago. He was in that triple threat match at Halloween Hijinks, which Ollie Green won. So, a little bit of unfinished business there for Chris Archer, perhaps. I'm looking forward to see this match anyway, because when you see Chris Archer matches, you know they're going to be like at least solid. You know, that's the bare line there. It's the starting point. It's a solid, good match. You know, everything else is a bonus after that. And Ollie Green, the matches I've seen, I've really enjoyed him as a wrestler. I've really enjoyed his work. I think he's going to be a guy that we're going to see more of next year. Hopefully on more main shows, because I think he's had... Oh, I'm trying to remember. One main show this year? No, has he? I didn't say the Regal Rumble. Regal Rumble was his debut. It wasn't the main show at Ariarki. Training Academy shows, yeah, he was. It was a match with Chris Archer. There you go, they're kind of... So they've got, again, they've got unfinished business as a singles match, because Archer attacked Ollie Green after his match, if I remember rightly. Or I think I Tommy Naden. I think it's only green. I apologise, I'm sorry. It's very easy to mix those two up, they look nothing alike. So, it wasn't, was it the main show part? No, it wasn't, because he was in the six man against the outfit. I was pre-show, I think. Inverurie was pre-show as well, as triple threat with Tommy and Connor. And yeah, so he hasn't actually been on a main show yet, so I think he's good enough to be on those main shows. And he's got a good look, he's got the tattoos and all that kind of stuff to be there. So I think another win here, a win over Chris Archer, who has, I don't think he's really picked up many, if any, wins. Possibly right at the bit start of the year, I think he'd beaten Oli Green for that smash I'm thinking of, at the training academy, but he lost to Vago at Anarchy, but he may have won one of the pre-show matches elsewhere. Anyway, that's not really the important thing here. He's trying to get back on his feet as a singles wrestler again, but even if Green, even he has had the best year, Green would still be up against someone who's a former tag team champion, former tri-counties champion, there's two cows fighting. So it's a win over Chris Archer and then making two wins on the bounce. That's a great start into 2024, into the end of 2023 for Oli Green. So yeah, the bare minimum here is going to be a solid match. It's going to be entertaining, I'm going to enjoy it, it's going to be fun, you know? It may not, set the world on fire, you know, it might not be five-star classic, or whatever you want to call it, but you know you're going to be entertained, it's going to be a serviceable match, you're going to enjoy it. It's going to be clean, it's going to be smooth. Archer may not be clean in the match, he may be use some underhand tactics, but I think this is going to be a really good showcase for Oli Green, so he can bounce and move into the main shows next year. So I think they've got their first shows January 20th. Where is it? I think Rich Energy Arena, I think it's called. I'm not sure. I have no idea where it is. I'm going to see how the weather is after Christmas and if there's still tickets available, plot or get a ticket for it. Right about this time of year, especially January, the roads from Elgin to Aberdeen are fucking horrific. They can be horrendous. So I'm kind of hesitating to get a ticket just yet, but we'll see how we go from there. But a new venue, it looks like a big venue as well, so possibly planting the seeds if they do well at that venue. We'll see it as a future place for an Abigariki if they're going to try to attempt to do a two night again like they did before the pandemic cancelled everything. So that's pretty sure it's going to be a good match, I know that, and that's the guarantee. It's whether it's going to be more than that, we'll soon find out, but I think it's going to be a great showcase for Oli. Archer's going to do what Archer does. I think he's now back to his Terry Funk gear. So he's got a little bit of that wrestling kind of edge to his maneuvers. A little bit of dirtiness to his antics, like dirt behind the fingernails kind of grubbiness to it. I think it's going to be it's going to be good. It's going to be good. Good match. Right, kid, mate. So on to the main show. Double checking. We're still recording. Ace. So we've got six matches on that show. I've remembered what all of them are this time. You don't know that I forgot one, but I told you right by the start of this. And I got really excited when I remembered which one it was. But yeah, I'm not going to tell you which one it was, because I'm fairly certain the people in the match don't particularly like me. And I don't want to piss them off any further. If I can absolutely avoid it. So we're going to start with the single matches. We'll go with the matches that are non-title, and then the back half will be the ones that are title matches. And hopefully we'll come to the end and we'll have a nice old time. And I've recorded all of it and we're all happy. So we'll start with Dino versus Zach Dynamite in a match where interesting wording was no members of the Foundation of the Future and the Outfit can interfere. That's what the contract is signed to say, that no members, no official members, I think was the wording, no official members of the Foundation of the Future and the Outfit or the Outfit can interfere. Which automatically makes me think, who's getting a new member of their stable at Christmas Chaos. That's my first thought, you know. Has Zach, Dino, and Zach or Dino, still works. Zach or Dino been recruiting behind the scene? Has Ted recruited a new member of the outfit? Has Zach convinced someone to join the Foundation of the Future as a protege? We won't actually officially join until after the match because they're an official member of the Foundation of the Future. That's the wording that makes me the most curious. This match itself, by all accounts, from what I've heard, what I've read, what I've listened to through things like the Mosh Pit, these two guys don't hold back. They're, what's the word? Snug. They like to lay into each other, into their opponents. They like to make sure their opponents know they're in a match, they're in a fight, they're in a battle. And I think that you put two people like that into one match, then you're going to get a heavy hitting match. You know, Dynamite is going to give up height, it's going to give up possibly strength advantage as well, but what he gains is experience, speed as well. It just makes it a very, I think it's going to be a very beautiful match, you know. Not one of those where I've used the word beautiful, like it's going to be very pretty. It's not going to be very pretty. It's going to be hard hitting. That's the word. I've already used that phrase for this match, but it's going to be hard hitting. Dino's had a great year so far. The start off did great. It wasn't great, to be honest. He missed Summer Hill Showdown. He didn't win the ladder match at RNRK, and then the outfit and foundation started colliding from Battle of Nations onwards. Then dominated with the pre-show of Nations, and then they cost Zach Dynamite the Tri-Counties Championship later on in the night. And so Dino knocked out Bruiser Brad in Varuni, like knocked him out, and then we had the foundation losing to the outfit at Halloween Hijinks. So the outfit have had a great year. Dino's had a very good year in the back half especially. So to come out against Zach, I think it's going to be a dark horse. It's going to be a very, very good match. It's going to be very good. I'm looking forward to it. I think it's going to be an absolute... What's the cliche we're going to use for this one? Barn burner. It's going to be a log burner in the other match. It's going to be great. I can't wait to see it. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. As well, so they've certainly heat up the venue, especially now we're sitting at -3 on our way to Aberdeen, just passing slightly to Harlaw, which I think possibly helped one of the first Aberdeen Anarchies, because I think it was Harlaw Academy, I think. I don't know. Harlaw Academy. Anyway, right, I'll be in Harlaw. Northeast is weird for that. Just random names for things, places. So we'll move on to. We'll go Christmas Brawl next, which is Damien against Captain Alan Sterling. Revolutionary Alan Sterling picked up a win at Halloween Hijinks over Damien in the Halloween Switcheroo match. So we've got a little bit of unfinished business there for Damien. He's wanted to maybe put Captain Alan to rest, maybe move it to 1-1. We'll see something develop a Granite City Showdown between the two. A final rubber match. I can't remember if I said this in my preview, but the preview of the of Hollywood Hijinks with Blue Thunder. But Captain Allen may be a buffoon, it may have this silliness about him, but he's a really accomplished, he's a good wrestler, and it makes it, I think, more annoying for people, you know, that you watch it and you go. And you go, you see this really accomplished wrestler do these really stupid things, and then he wins. He lost a match. Oh, come on, get my wipers going. One is frozen, one is unfrozen, and it's making everything very awkward. How many matches has he lost this year? He beat Evan Young at Anarchy. He beat Deacon Matthews at Nations. Oh, Christ. Turn off wipers here. So it beat Deacon Matthews at Nations. It's beat Damien. He lost the tag match in Ferrari. But again, not a singles match. I don't think he's lost a singles match this year that I can remember. I could be wrong. I don't remember a lot of things. So I don't think he's lost a singles match this year. So he's coming in against Damien, who will be annoyed. He hasn't had a great year. Started off being injured from Christmas Chaos. He then got re-injured, and then he got stabbed by Ronan King, Ariarake, and then he's been dragged into this nonsense with Captain Allen as well. And then lost as well at Halloween Hijinks. I don't know how the hooker crook or whatever it was that made it so, but he still has a loss against his name as well. So Damien's got a lot to kind of try and bounce back from this year. It's probably not been his best year, and Allen has had a good year. He's had a great year. So just to see if Damien can get past the buffoonery. It's in a Christmas brawl, though. Christmas brawl, the rules are any Christmas item is legal. That's the referee's discretion, etc., etc. So we've seen in the past, last year Christmas Chaos, Captain Allen employed the services of the Outfit, Murphy and Dino, and they came out wearing tinsel necklaces and Santa jackets, and they were classed as Christmas weapons, and it was allowed. I think a Cameron Boone's referee, I think it may have been Ollie Green, it may have been Dennis Law, because if something goes wrong, it's probably Dennis. So we've got that. So he knows how to skirt the rules. He knows how to Mickey Vago it. He knows how to make it just about legal for it to be legal, you know? So we'll have to see if he's got any shenanigans afoot, or if Damien is able to find some Christmas wares, get some kendo sticks with or Singapore canes with some tinsel on them. Singapore candy canes. There we go. That's made me laugh there. That's the most important thing. Oh fuck, is it a detour? No, there's not, please. So we've got that. I think it's going to be a shenanigan filled frenzy. I had loads of nice Christmas puns the last episode, I promise you. There was loads, and now I forgot them all. So to do the first half of matches, the non-title matches, we've got Mickey Vago against Judas Gray in a match I am buzzing for, because I've seen Judas wrestle once, and it was online. It was a community pro show. It was against Zero. So we're going to get to see a lot of what Judas can do. I've seen clips of things from like's community pro and disco, and Judas is very enigmatic. You know, he's got that Jeff Hardy kind of recklessness in his wrestling. What I want to see, and having spoken to him through for the podcast, and recently offending him on the Halloween Hijinks quiz, I'm really excited to see him in person and actually get to see Judas Gray do what people are raving about for him. He gets Mickey Vago, who's had a great year. I would say he's had a fantastic return since the show's came back. He's been Tri-County's champion. He's had amazing matches in the Mosh Pit. It's been the main event in the last three shows as well. Hijinks, Nations, and Inferiori, all in title matches. It wasn't successful, but the fact that he's been put into those high profile title matches on shows just shows the faith that the WrestleZone have in him, and the performances that he's put in, the consistent performances he's put in to carry those shows in the main event with Aspen, with Caleb, and the likes, you know. So I think it's going to be very good. Again, it's not going to be, I don't think it's going to be a particularly wrestling match. It's going to be a good bit of a scrap, a good bit of a brawl, a good bit of a high fly from Judas, a little bit of cartwheeling from Vago. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. It's just going to be a fun match. Good. And I think Vago is a really great opponent for an introduction to the WrestleZone audience for Judas Gray, who we've seen some promo videos. He's very cocky, very arrogant. He's got a kinship, a friendship with Ronan King as well. So we don't know if Ronan King will be involved, depending on when the match is, I suppose, placed in the card. Fago will have Tommy Raiden, his new protege, whether we'll see that develop into just a protege relationship or we'll see it develop into a tag team in the future. That's probably going to be into next year. But I'm interested to see if Tommy's going to be a bit more heavy metally, if he's going to have a prospect jacket or what have you. He's going to kind of have a battle jacket, and just kind of jazz up his look a little bit. Because when this was put together, the protege thing, I looked at it and I thought, you know what, I think Ollie would have been a really good mesh for that character, for that partnership, but Tommy's been chosen. I think he's probably going to excel at it. I'm just interested to see how they mix up his looks. He's very white meat, very clean cut, you know, in comparison to the heavy metal hooligan and all that kind of stuff. So I'm just interested to see where that goes from there. It's going to be very interesting. The clash of styles, the clash of heavy metal against emo. I assume a lot of things about Judas Grey, it seems. I just hope that they put in a great showcase and get to see Judas again in WrestleZone in 2024. Because I think he's just, from what I've seen and from what I've heard, what I've interacted with, he seems like a really good guy, even though you're going to probably hate him for 20 minutes. Or, well, it's Fable, 8 minutes. You're going to hate him for 8 minutes, and you're going to. You love doing it. It's like Ronan. It's like you hate Ronan, but he's that guy. He's that good. You know. You just go, oh, I wish I could cheer you, you prick. You know, that kind of reaction to him. So it should be good. Should be good fun. Next up, let's talk about Ronan. We'll go Ronan. Ronan versus Caleb Valhalla. Valhalla defends the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship, even though at the moment Ronan is in possession of the title belt after kicking Caleb in the chestnuts at Halloween Hijinks following disqualification after Ronan spat in the face of Caleb, and Caleb decided to punch him in the face in the corner a lot of times over the 5 count. And after their separation, kick, low blowed Caleb, took the title belt, and they took it Union Square for the lulz. So this is one of those matches where, in my brain, I'm okay with whoever wins. You know, I love Caleb, and if he retains, brilliant. In my brain, if Ronan wins, fantastic, great wrestler, really enjoy him as a wrestler, got to speak to him on the podcast, brilliant, you know, ace. In my heart, though, Ronan's a prick, and I don't want him to win the title. You know, so I'm just like going, kill him, you know, kill that man, because he spat in your face, and then low blowed you, and then took your possession, and you need his comeuppance. He's had a wild year, has Ronan King, not just in Aberdeen, but in other places as well. He's been really getting showcased this year, and he needs humbling, you know. But at the same time, I think he's a great wrestler, so if he wins the title, like, ace, that's a great accomplishment for him. But at the same time, you're a prick, Ronan, and I want Caleb to kill you. So, you know, duality of man. Is that a phrase? I don't know. Who cares? Like I said, I've recorded this twice now, so I may be adding some cool things at this occasion. I may have forgotten loads of stuff and just floating it in. You don't know. You won't know. Next up, tag title match. Fatal 4-Way. It is the foundation of the future. That's Bruiser Brad Evans and Ryan Riley defending that title, those titles, against the team of Mr. Omar Mohammed and Mr. WrestleZone. The Warriors against low-life entities, Brian Tucker and Reese Dawkins. The final team is the Outfit, Ted O'Keefe and Murphy. Murphy, Murphy, Murphy. So, 4 teams which I can honestly say, I don't know who's going to win. And it's one of those ones, again, much like the Tri-Counties title match, I think any of them could win. So, for those who are unaware of what Fatal 4-Way matches are, they're no DQ, no championship advantage. Anyone can pin any other team, I assume. mean, there was that kind of moments we've seen where teams have tried to pin each other in four-way matches. I don't know if it's ever legally worked in wrestling. But, I'll see. If Dennis is refing, I'll have my eye on it. I love you, Dennis. Merry Christmas. We've got four teams that have been kind of split off this year. We've had Dawkins and Tucker with Mr. WrestleZone and Omar. They've been going at it for Omar especially has been going at it with these two for over a year. Mr. WrestleZone only debuted at the Regal Rumble, and he was quickly thrust in to this shenanigan fest with Dawkins and Tucker. So that's been going on for quite a while. The outfit, I've got First Blood over the Foundation of the Future when they won the six-man at Halloween Hijinks. So they've been going at it since about August time. August time. So they've got a little bit of very recent history with each other. And I think it's the first time we're seeing Ted and Murphy team up as a tag team. So will that work out? Well, because of the nature of it being a fatal four-way tag team match, there's going to be lots of bodies. It just takes 3 seconds for that three count to go. Murphy could pin Mr. WrestleZone. We could see Omar pin Ted O'Keefe. We could see Dawkins pin Mr. WrestleZone. We could see any combination of pinnage here. And the Foundation of the Future don't have to be involved. So this is probably the most risk that the Foundation will have with their titles, because they don't have to be involved. The outfit and the Foundation could roll to the back, and it leaves just Dawkins, Tucker, Mr. WrestleZone, and Omar. That could happen, you know? So there is a possibility that Brad and Ryan will be nowhere near the ring when the final bell goes, which makes it that jeopardy of this match. It makes it a little bit interesting, a bit intriguing as well. So I don't know who's going to win. I can see any team walking out with the titles tonight. I'm not a betting man. Because I know I'm really bad at WrestleZone especially. So Foundation lost last year Christmas Chaos to the Fair City Saints, and then Zach lost the title at the main event of that show. So Christmas Chaos recently hasn't really held well for the Foundation. I'm not saying that's a sign, but it could be a factor. There's some confidence that maybe it needs the community centre. That's when the Foundation regained the titles when they beat Webb and Miles, the Fair City Saints, at Armory Anarchy. So you know, it's an interesting venue for the Foundation. We'll see if luck goes their way on that particular, on tonight, this particular evening. And finally, as I'm getting into Aberdeen, because I had to re-record this, we've got the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship match with Lost Boy Aspen defending against Connor Malloy. And Connor is cashing in his title opportunity win that he got at Armory Anarchy in that ladder match, and he's going for it. Now, all the build-up of this has been Connor being the underdog. He's been the underdog when he started, when he was getting about with Christian Crabbe. So he's been the underdog. So he's been the underdog for a good portion of his career, and since Crusher had retired, he's kind of been a little bit limbo about what he's been doing, how he's been involved with WrestleZone. So we've got that factor involved, where he's been the underdog, so he knows what it's like to fight from underneath. It seems not a lot of people have given him any chance to win. We saw that little video where the WrestleZone roster were asked about the match. The majority were saying that Aspen was going to win. Aspen himself seems to be underestimating Connor and tell good luck in the Rumble, you know. So all wrestling tropes point to Connor winning, you know. We watch wrestling long enough, guys. We know how this goes. all tropes point to Conor winning, but I don't think so. And I'll tell you for why. I think we're going to see Conor lose, and I think it's going to be quite pretty well to watch. You know, I think he's going to have some good chances, going to have some good moments, some close calls. Going to be, oh my God, you know. But we're going to see eventually. Aspen is going to give him a couple pile drivers, whatever he needs to do. Edit with the darkest lariat. Maybe give him a bit of a battle in afterwards. And we're going to see Conor defeated. His title shot gone, and he's going to have to be the underdog, be the underdog that people loved him for in WrestleZone. And we're going to see Conor win the Regal Rumble. That's my prediction. I don't do many predictions because I'm really bad at it in WrestleZone, but that's what I'm going with. I think we're going to see Aspen win, and then we're going to see Conor Malloy win the Regal Rumble and be a main event and get a rematch against Aspen. I could be totally wrong. We could be, you'll see whatever montage I've cobbled together, and then after the show, me going, oh my God, Conor won. Absolutely could be possible. Again, much like the Ronin Caleb match, I would watch it going, Conor has put in the work. Man, he's earned it. He's earned to be the top dog in WrestleZone. At the same time, I don't want him to win because Aspen's my boy. So I've got to accept it. I don't have to like it, but I've just got to accept it, you know? I did a whole big bit about this in the previous non-recording, but I think I need to kind of get my old mappage out. I mean, it's only 10 to 3, tons of time. We're going to try going to the beach. That's what we're going to try to do. I know how to get there, I think, without the maps. You think I know by now, you know? I've done enough going to these shows. I should know my way around, but I don't. Unless it's a northern hotel or the beach ballroom, I have no earthly idea where I'm going in Aberdeen when it comes to venues without the use of Google Maps. But anyway, I'm looking forward to this. I've rambled another... I was able to scrape 40 minutes out of this. Able to ramble about. My phone stayed in the same place for the whole time. That's really exciting. Now I know for the future when I'm doing a road trip, if I go to Granny City Showdown in January, I know that's what I need to do. I need to put my phone into the tripod and then ram the fucker into the chair here. So I look forward to this. It's going to be a really fun show. I can feel it. I'm so glad I'm able to see Wrestle one more time this year. Like I say, should have seen them in Halloween Hijinks, but it didn't work out that way. So we're going to go see them at Christmas Chaos, the Deeston Community Centre. It is weird that I did the Wrestle podcast and the shows are sold out. So it seems futile doing the Wrestle podcast sometimes when that's the case. But I still enjoy it. I still going to talk about WrestleZone because it's a company I really enjoy and enjoy watching. Other than that, before I go to the montage, if you're watching this, listening to this, we have episodes planned up to the end of January. That's the finale, will be the year-end awards. I'll record that probably middle of the month after the voting's closed, and I've got a bit of time to do it. I'll probably pick a Monday and just rattle through them and talk about the winners and etc. and the SWN 150 and all that kind of stuff. As well, we've got preview planned for Christmas Day. Other than that, I've got a couple interviews coming up. By the time this comes out, I will have recorded, should have recorded with Legends Never Die and Sammy Sparks and Fulton King. I do have an episode after that to record. I don't think I do. I think after Legends Never Die, I've got the year end awards preview. And that might be it. Oh, no way, I've got one on the 11th. Who's that with? Patrick Petersky from Fair State Wrestling. Okay, yeah, that's my last actual interview recording of the season. But I've still got spaces, so I'm trying to fill them in so I can maybe do two episodes a week into January and finish on 250, but I think we're going to finish on episode 245 or something for season 6. But then I'll take a wee break, try to get some recordings done February time for maybe a March return. I don't know. I've kind of half thought, but not really thought about it. Anyway, it should be montage time next. maybe I'll grab people before the show if possible. Like I said, I haven't asked to do it, so I'm not expecting anything. But failing all that, you'll see a montage, and you'll get to see my immediate thoughts following the show itself. So I'm going to try and stop the recording without too much awkwardness, and let's go find Deanston Community Centre again. We can do this, can't we, guys? Throat is ruined. I'll be perfectly honest with you guys. So this is the fun bit where I've put the camera in my dash here because I can't be bothered setting up the thing. Hopefully after the montage, you've seen a nice montage. Quite a lot of video in the montage this week, this edition, I think, possibly, unless I've absolutely fucked up. As you can hear, this wasn't really due to the show. My throat was kind of killing me anyway, because I had to do, two 45-minute intros, and only one recorded, and then I stood in line for an hour before the show in -3 degrees, so I am probably not going to be in a great shape on Monday when I record the in studio bit where I kind of gather my thoughts over the weekend and tell you what happened to the show that I enjoyed. But another good night. Probably not my favourite show of the year, I'll be perfectly honest there, for WrestleZone. But again, that could be due to me feeling like utter shit. But going through the show, going through the card briefly as I drive home. Who's gonna drive you home?
tonight, me. We had the open, the doors opened on time, and I'll be honest, right at bang on six, I think it was bang on six, folks started chapping on the door of the venue to open up and started going, open up, and if it wasn't minus three, I would have been right stubborn. I don't know if it was Martin maybe that was in charge, I would have kept those doors shut for longer, because did I bang the door? That's rude. That's rude. No, you wait. But I'm glad they opened the doors in time. That was nice, and I could try and get warm. I didn't really get warm the whole night. I screwed the pooch with my outfit choice again. I wore a jumper this time. I thought that would be the difference maker. I was wrong. So wrong. But the show itself. So starting off with Ollie Green and Chris Archer. Ollie Green picking up the win. A nice match. As I previewed and thought it would be. I thought it would be just a really nice match. We're going to see Ollie pick up a win. Got some great stuff from Chris Archer. Ollie looking promising. He's definitely a guy that I want to see at the main shows next year. He's got a little bit of character about him. I think he could probably get tap into more of that in the future when he gets on to get in on a main show. Even though the crowd isn't that different for a VIP and a main show, it's about like four people. It's still a different vibe when it comes onto the main card, I think, in my opinion anyway, from my years watching. There's a little bit of a different vibe from the main show than the VIP. So hopefully we'll see that. And it was a good match. I think particularly, like I said in the preview, I didn't think it was going to light the world on fire, but I didn't think they were going to shit the bed either. It was just a really good match. What did the main show kick off with? It kicked off with the Strikers match. Ronan and Caleb. So Caleb picked up the win with a spear out of nowhere. So before the match, this is a nitpick I've got here. Before the match, it was announced that if Caleb got DQ'd, then Ronan would win the belt. Okay, ace. I get that. That's a very easy stipulation. I didn't feel like they used that stipulation. I think they could have. It was a good match, but I think there was some miscommunication moments, some rough moments in it, admittedly. But overall, good match. I think if they used that stipulation more, they could have went from good to great. Like, they could have had Ronan spitting in Caleb's face again, you know? And they could have had Caleb just almost getting DQ'd. Like, remember the Randy Orton Christian series? Christian win the world title second time by DQ. I think they could have done more with that. So I think that was maybe a misstep. Like I say, it was a good match, but I think it could have been great if they used that stipulation more and made it more integrated with the match and the story itself. I enjoy both guys. I think it was good, but could have been better. Could have been better with a few tweaks in my mind anyway. What was after that? I'm relying on my memory here, and it's not a good thing. So I can remember what the first half main was. I remember what the second half was. So what was the second match? Oh no, this is terrible. It was Dino and Zach. That was it. Dino and Zach. Again, I thought it was just going to be a big slugfest kind of thing. We're going to see Dynamite use somebody's quickness. We're going to see Dino batter him, but Dino came out with a bandaged arm. So that changed the dynamic of the match entirely to being Dino fighting from underneath. He used some great things, like using his other arm, his left arm, for the rolling elbow. There were some nice little bits with using it. It was a very rough match, but I think the roughness and the storyline that's involved with the outfit and the foundation definitely helped with it, and it made that match. It didn't really have to be pretty, because these two factions are at war. They've got a bone to pick with each other. They're not going to try and be particularly nice to each other in that respect. So big hits, big heavy hits. Dynamite is probably got one of my favourite elbow drops now. It used to be Archer. I think Archer would be moved just in a second. I think I like Zach's like dropping one. There's not that much air time to it, but it kind of just gracefully floats down. It's a really nice elbow drop. So say about that. It was a rough match, but because of the story, kind of worked with it. Worked with these two. I liked it, and I would maybe see it again when I have Dino healed up after the match. Dynamite. I mean, they stuck to their word. The outfit and the foundation didn't interfere. There was no additional member of either group. It was just a straight up match. Who won that? I think it was Dino. Dino ended up winning that. I can't remember how. I will look at my photos and try to remember. But it was cool. Dino used his head more because his right arm was injured, and there was nice little moments with that. So yeah, really good match. I'd like to see that again at some point, which I think we will, with the whole outfit thing, outfit and foundation thing not totally resolved tonight. First half main was the Christmas Brawl. That was Damien and Captain Allen. Ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous, and they didn't go whole. I think they went silly. They didn't go whole hog silly. I think they could have went sillier, but Captain Allen brought out his Santa first mate. I can't remember what he called it, which was definitely not Evan Young. And it was definitely not Evan Young in a Grinch outfit and a Santa suit. That's definitely I would not believe the rumour if that's what comes out. Unfortunately, someone started the rumour that I was the Santa that came out. So during the match, before the match, Damien said, "Oh, it's unfair. You've got someone with you. I'm going to bring out someone who's big and loves Christmas." I initially thought it was going to be Crusher Crabe. But it wasn't, and it was going to be Santa, and out came Mr. WrestleZone, a Santa hat and a Santa jacket on back to front, which didn't seem to be the plan for Damien, and Omar Mohammed came out and dragged Mr. WrestleZone to the back. So it was 2-1 for quite a lot of the match. We got some silly stuff with, at one point, both of them brought out selection boxes and whacked each other with them, but then they just kind of took a pause for a moment and had a bit of chocolate. And then Santa, the Santa sailor, Sea Santa, I think that's what it was called, jumped on Damien like it was Mini-Me after chocolate, which is probably a moment you'd kind of really enjoy if he sees it. So I had that, and then Santa came out to save the day, and more than one person thought I was Santa, which is ridiculous, because I was sitting in the crowd. Why did people say that? I didn't like it. I didn't really like it because you know, I know I'm a tubby fella. And the fella that was Santa Claus, he's known to be jolly and got a bowl full of jelly, you know? And I looked at him and thought, you know what people think what I look like? Like, screw you guys. A little bit hurt my feelings, you know? Arses. So Damien won, and now we're 1-1, so I think we're gonna see something happened at Grand City Showdown on January 20th at Rich Energy Arena. I got it right in the preview. Well, chuffed myself for that. So that was the first half main. During the interval, I got a picture of Damien, because it's probably the only way I'm going to get him on the podcast is with a picture or a montage. But for some Christmas cheer, he gave me hope that we'll possibly see Damien in the future on the podcast. So maybe next year we will live in hope. But yeah, absolute silliness. Good fun. Some brutal moments with baubles smashing everywhere. There was like a plate got broken at one point as well. But yeah, it was just silly, fun, madcap, just all of the above. What you expect from Captain Allen. And it was great to see Damien kind of get involved with the shenanigans as well. It was just a nice laugh. And as Damien did tell me, that's probably the only match, that's the first match in a while in Daidston that he came out injury free. So that was nice. Even though he did do a senton onto a bobble that just smashed as well, so they're probably lucky he didn't have some shards of plastic or glass in his back after that. Oh, he's already had glass in his eye once this year after he got stabbed by Ronan. Second half, what was happening there? So it kicked off with the tag title match. which was wild. It was just people and bodies everywhere. Eventually, Mr. WrestleZone and Ryan Riley started brawling towards the entranceway, and in the meantime, the outfit took advantage, and Murphy and Ted O'Keefe are now the WrestleZone Tag Team Champions. There were a lot of shenanigans with things like Mr. WrestleZone and Tucker and Dawkins. But yeah, it was just really, really fun, blinking you'll miss it kind of. Lots of little things happening in the match that I really liked. There were some rough bits and some bits like that, but all in all, really enjoyed it. It was just a good bit of fun. Like I said in the preview, I kind of could see any team winning. I was starting to lean towards Mr. WrestleZone and Omar, but the outfit are now tag team champions. So Foundation now have a really rough record in Dave's Security Centre recently, certainly since the restart shows. So we'll see where that goes in the future. We'll see as well, because we saw the Foundation of the Future again later in the night. Penultimate match was Mickey Vago versus Judas Grey. Mickey Vago had Tommy Raiden, who was still just Tommy Raiden. There was no kind of additional Vago-ness about him just yet. Judas came out and threw his really heavy jumper in my face, which had my glasses fly. Judas, much like Ronan, thank God that you're a very talented and charismatic wrestler, because you're a prick at the same time. That kind of shocked me. It shouldn't have shocked me, I don't think, but yeah, well, I've had that. That's been described home, but I'll do finish up the preview, the review-ish before I go in. We had that. We didn't really get to see all that Judas could do, but we got little glimpses. I think that was enough for people to like, when they saw Judas, he was cocksure and very confident. He had this little bit of flamboyancy about him as well. People were, he ground gears very quickly and very easily. And so we got to see a little bit of what he can do, but not everything that he can do, which is good. We want to see him back. I want to see Judas back up in WrestleZone, certainly. He was, it was a nice little mini showcase. And we got to see what the start of this fake Mickey Vago, Tommy Raiden relationship is going to be. And it seems to be Tommy Raiden getting into Vago's business without Vago asking. Because Raiden got into Judas's face. Judas antagonized Raiden quite a bit as well, but Tommy kept trying to get involved. Eventually, Judas tried to take the Singapore cane from Tommy, had a little bit of a back and forth. Judas got the Singapore cane, tried to go in the ring with it. Dennis took it away. And then, in the distraction, Tommy Raiden hit Judas, which sent him kind of like, how dare you? I can't believe you actually hit me. And then he went into the ring and got a stunner. I think that was how it finished was. So Vago won. But I think this is going to develop further with Tommy doing underhanded things to try and help Vago, which Vago, I don't think, will appreciate. Or maybe he will. And eventually we'll see that spiral into some terribleness from Mickey Vago's end. So from that point... just to point out with the referees tonight. So Mikey Innes wasn't one of the referees tonight. So we got a young lad, and he was refereeing the Zack Dynamite Dino match. And there were some bits like with submissions and that looked like Dino was struggling quite a bit, you know, because with the injured arm. See my face. Hello. And I was hearing the commentary behind me that was great, because it pointed out that because the referee was a bit more inexperienced, experienced referee like Dennis, like Mikey, may have ended the match sooner due to unable to compete any further, you know. I liked that little bit of storyline subtlety thrown into the match. I was noticing it, but I liked hearing the commentary point out as well, like I wasn't imagining it myself. Before the raffle, we had Mr. WrestleZone was doing the raffle. Omar apparently had been taken to hospital due to a slight injury in the tag team match. If that was the case, then hopefully it's nothing too serious. So Mr. WrestleZone did the raffle. That was a good little laugh. eventually the foundation came out after Mr. WrestleZone tried to wish everyone a Merry Christmas. This was beautiful. Right, so during the tag team match, Mr. WrestleZone did like a moonlight driver, like a standing spin neckbreaker thing, which was very synonymous with Scottie Swift in WrestleZone. And during the match, I think it was Tucker, possibly Dawkins as well, kept shouting that that was Scottie Swift's move. And again, commentary pointed out as well that was a move that Scottie Swift did. So during this little bit here with Mr. WrestleZone and the foundation, intimidated Mr. WrestleZone. Mr. WrestleZone's like, I'm not stupid, I'm going to leave. And just as he was leaving, Zach Dynamite said that Mr. WrestleZone was a coward and someone like Scottie Swift wouldn't walk away from this. And then that set off Mr. WrestleZone. Oh, I love this. I love where they're going to go. I don't know where they're going to go with it, but I love that moment. That was so good. Especially for people, especially those that were at Christmas Chaos last year. We saw Scottie Swift retire. That was just, chef's kiss. Unfortunately, I did have Mr. WrestleZone getting a pile driver, a spike pile driver from all three members of the foundation. So it didn't really end well for Mr. WrestleZone, but I am so excited for 2024 with that little tease there. Main event was Lost by Aspen defeating Connor. I really enjoyed this. Like, it started off with Aspen coming out in Christmas gear, Christmas Gansy. Not really taking the match that seriously. He was a bit silly. Fashionista here, judging someone's fashion choices. Connor gave him a slap to make him take the match seriously, which woke up Aspen after a flurry from Connor. And then a good bit of back and forth, but a lot of it was Connor maybe biting off more than he could chew. Good bit of counters as well. After that, I did worry that it was going to be, it's just going to be Aspen taking the piss. But then when it properly started going, it's like, oh man, Connor was really firing up. He was really doing really great things. And there was the moments, the little tease, the almost, and the two counts, the 2.9 counts. There was just so many little things. The match eventually ended with, I think it was Connor went for something, a crossbody perhaps. I do have footage of it, it'll be in the montage. It got countered into a tombstone attempt, and then Aspen tried to underhook the legs, roll up, and then Aspen was able to squeak the victory. So he was able to get the win there. Definitely a match that picked up, it definitely picked up as the match went on. Again, there was some little slips here and there, but if you take the match as a whole, really enjoyable, really enjoyed it. Afterwards, Aspen went to offer his hand to Connor. Connor slapped it away for a moment. Ronan King came out, started attacking Aspen. Connor pushed away. Ronan came up to get in Connor's face. Connor pushed Ronan out of the way and started beating down Aspen. So now we've got Ronan and Connor together, which I'm looking forward to. I think I mentioned it way back in our the Anarchy preview. I wanted to see these two team up in WrestleZone after seeing like clips and that of their time, their one match in CPW. Caleb Valhalla came out to make the save, and that's how we ended the show, with Caleb and Aspen in the ring and Connor and Ronan both adorning some lovely sunglasses and looking really proud of themselves. So that looks like that's the match for Granite City Showdown on January 20th. It'll be Skull Brawl against, I hope they go for Aberdeen Dream Team, because I really like that name. There was another name they used at CPW, I can't remember what it was, but I don't think it's anything better than Aberdeen Dream Team. The Aberdeen Dream Team, Aberdeen Dream. So we got that to end the show. Like I said, I think because my throat was gone and it was cold, I think I'm a little bit like laid down after the show. I'm like a little bit like I'm knackered. It's been a bit of a day, a bit of a long day, not long for in comparison to anyone else's standards, but just generally a bit of a long day. I feel a bit under the weather, but it was still a really strong show, a really strong show to end the year. So not my favourite of the year. There were some really good, fantastic shows this year actually for WrestleZone, but a really strong show to end 2023 on. Another great year for WrestleZone. I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to keep an eye on the weather, keep seeing forecasts before I decide if I'm going to Granite State Showdown, but hopefully I will, and we'll go to Rich Energy Arena. Hopefully I'll get Kelly along, because I think I found out tonight, I think I may have mentioned it in previous podcasts, I like going to shows there. It's way more fun because I get to see her natural reaction to moments and shows, and I think it makes me enjoy wrestling more, seeing her react to wrestling. So hopefully she'll be in the next preview, the next road trip episode, and we'll go see some wrestling next year. So before I go in and put the results on the website and go to bed, I think Kelly may have just went to bed. The light is off, so I'll go up and pester her and go to sleep, get changed, go to sleep. Fun night. I'll have more possibly intricate thoughts on Monday when I've maybe recovered a little bit and I don't sound like my voice is breaking constantly as well. So a good night. Like, I can't wait to see what this now leads into Regal Rumble, Avenue Anarchy season, because the theories are starting. The theories, the cards in my head are starting to be put together. I'm looking forward to seeing where it goes. But for now, possibly the next thing you'll see will be me. I'm all over the place. Be back in the studio. So, how you doing, future Billy?
Must be back in the studio. Hello. I sound better than I did during the recap episode. I think I do anyway. I feel better. I still look very pasty white, but the light is like right there. I don't really have a lot more to add, to be honest. I was watching back the footage that I got on the day. I made the montage and all that kind of stuff, and there's not an awful lot that I could really add on in the post that'll really add anything more to the episode. It's quite a beefy episode anyway. I did have a look at the 3 minutes I recorded. It didn't actually capture my phone dropping, so I have no idea what happened between like that bit and it not recording anything else. So I'm still going to put it at the end, though. You can see the first, was it 3 minutes? And I think it was like 20 seconds. I'll just have a look. Yep, 3 minutes, 21 seconds of rambling before everything went to shit. So elsewhere, though, I mean, despite me still not learning my lesson, next year I am either queuing at the last minute or I will actually remember to take a jacket, because last year I wore a t-shirt and a sleeveless hoodie. This year I wore a t-shirt and a Christmas jumper, thinking that would offset the coldness, but it was like -3 to -5 in that queue. So I hopefully will learn my lesson next year. It's all looking good for Grand City Showdown at the moment, weather depending. It is really icy out there today, as of recording, which is the Tuesday, the 5th of December. Really icy, really frosty. And I've got to go drive to Bucky tomorrow to drop off my boy at his grandparents for a night. So that'll be fun. But other than that, of the show itself, now I've been able to kind of decompress it a little bit. Like I said, there's not much more I can really add, but it was a really good show. Like I say, consistent show. I will probably confirm, well, it wasn't my favourite of the year, but to still put on a really great show and it not being my favourite, that's still pretty good. It's still a pretty good show. Even though he did throw his massive jumper in my face, seeing Judas Grey for the first time was great. Especially when we've kind of only interacted online and been able to see wrestle like maybe once or twice possibly in full on YouTube through Community Pro. I think it was so only once. So being able to actually see him live, and he does have this kind of enigmatic quality about him, and he's got this kind of coolness about him. It's probably kind of the same reason why I was drawn to Aspen in the first place as well, because he had this kind of coolness, mystery about him kind of thing, you know. Didn't really give a lot away in his actions, and Judas is kind of the same, and I'm really hoping that he becomes a fixture in WrestleZone in 2024, because there's plenty of people I want to see him against. A lot of them in my mind already are all bad guys, so there's a little bit of a weird dynamic there. So throw in some multi-man matches maybe, so we could get Ronin and Judas, we get Connor and Judas as well. But I thought Omar Judas is one. I was like, yeah, I want to see that. I want to see Omar versus Judas. I think it would be good. And throw him in against bigger guys like your Murphy, like your Bruiser Brad. Brad and Judas would create some magic. But this isn't the Judas show, even though he is excellent. And like I said, despite our little falling out on the night, I think it's the first time in a long time I've reacted to a wrestler. I think last time was, oh God, 2018 maybe, and I think it was Shawn Johnson who squared up to me, and I stood up, but since then I haven't done anything. And Foundation of the Future, like both shows, if I was front row with Kyle, they would Brad would really get in my face, and Zach would be a right dick and all that kind of stuff. And I don't know what it is. Something about Judas Grey just makes me just want to go, I reckon I'd probably take it, even though I definitely couldn't, because just look at him in comparison to me. Like I say, I wasn't Santa Claus, for anyone else asking. It must have been the real Santa Claus. That's the only explanation on the matter. I was taking a little bit of a break between getting all his elves to make all the toys while he does nothing. I lazy git. But you know, please don't leave coal for Jack. Please don't. So, yeah, like I said, there's not much more I can really add. It was a really good show. Looking forward to see what that progresses into 2024. WrestleZone remains one of my favorite promotions to go to, really, because not just because of the convenience of being the closest, but also because it provides a great night of entertainment that I enjoy. And, you know, I like to look at the positives of wrestling, and WrestleZone just kind of ticks all the boxes for me. And we'll see what tonight, well, what Saturday will mean for 2024, and with things like the Mr. WrestleZone and the Foundation, Connor and Ronan now teaming up, the Skull Brawl now being a thing in WrestleZone as well, and Fago and Tommy Raiden, Ollie Green getting two wins on the bounce. So there's a lot to look into, especially when they're trying to fill out a big arena next year, the Rich Energy Arena. I think it certainly looks bigger from photos than a lot of venues that they've done recently. I think probably comparative, maybe the Leisure Centre. That would probably be the biggest one prior, I would think. That would, like, one that is actually a paid crowd, not like a gala or a Comic-Con or something like that, but an actual wrestling crowd that are here to see wrestling, you know? So they've got a task ahead of them, and they've sold out shows pretty much all year, into last year as well. So they certainly have the demand for it. I'm just interested to see if they bring in a Joe Hendry or a Grado or something, just to sweeten the pot, you know, just to sweeten that pot. But I'll hopefully be there again. It'll be weather depending, and hopefully we'll have Kelly in hand as well, because I like going to the wrestling shows with her. So she's good company, a great company for shows, because she does all the reacting that I don't. But other than that, I got a new Aspen T-shirt, because of course I did. The Halloween one, got it at Christmas Chaos, because it's a good Halloween hijinks. So yeah, I'll sign off then. Hope you enjoyed the montage. Hope you enjoyed my name rambling for in the car. So my side profile, and then the inane rambling afterwards. It was in the dark. I had a lot of fun, and I'm looking forward to Grand State Showdown January 20th next week. I think on the podcast is Rolling Kings episode. It's a great episode. I won't lie, it was one of my favorites to record. Ronan's one of those guys where I'd have to say the same for Zach Dynamite. For 20 minutes or 2-3 hours of a wrestling show, hate him. Like, he's a horrid human being. After, but outside of those walls, can't praise him enough. He's a fantastic talent, great attitude. Is really, really not even a diamond in the rough. He's really shining now, and as we go into the next few years, I think Ronan King's going to be a name that you see in a lot of places, and for good reason. Anyway, go follow us, swnscotland.com. That's our website, @ScottResNet, just about everywhere else. I'm going to go rest my throat now. for because I've still got two recordings this week. I've got Legends Never Die, that's the next one I'm recording. Then we've got our Christmas party that I'm recording on Thursday with Kyle Watt and Kaylee. That's from K&K Wrestle Factory or wherever their podcast may be called in the future. So I've got a lot of things to do. My throat's gonna go heal. So let's go get some honey and be quiet for the rest of the day. Have a good one, guys. Hello and welcome. Oh, that was really loud. I'm so sorry about that. Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And for the final time in season six, which initially was supposed to be an on-tour season, we're on tour. So we're in seven, I think I've done about 35 episodes or something this season, and I've only actually had seven. Well, this will be the seventh road trip, actual road trip of the plan. Because I didn't really anticipate doing so many interviews for this season. And always the case, if you don't anticipate doing that many, always ends up getting absolutely loads. So that's why this season's going to end in like January, end of January, with our year-end awards, which I'll record middle of January. But after next week, I don't have any more recordings for the year because I will have been too far ahead. I'll be like 6 weeks ahead with scheduling, and I've gone into the problems before, like really early on, I think maybe seasons two to three, where I had episodes recorded and finished up, and there was 3 months gap between the episode actually being done and the episode going out publicly. So I don't want to. 6 weeks I would even say that it's too long, but just so I had plenty of episodes done. Or I was ended up getting plenty of episodes done before taking a break for Christmas. That's just how it's ended up. So I'm still doing one a week, I think. And I think we're doing a preview of the year-end awards for Christmas Day. I think that's the plan. I can't remember. It's been a long year in general. For our first full year, you know, doing this whole dad thing. It's been an adventure. And we've got plenty. But somehow, we've got plenty of recordings and episodes and interviews and road trips and on location bits, and it's been a really great year for the podcast, especially recently. Every episode since October has hit 100 listens, at least 100 listens within a couple of days. At least I think I may have said in the past, I don't know whether I've broken something on the algorithm or if I've broken something on the website, because most of our listens come through that. So if there's a big news story or a big results happening, or I get ICW results or something, then it's a spike in our listenership because it's a spike on the website hits. I don't really want to question it too much in case it breaks and it stops doing that, but in the meantime I'm just going to enjoy being the, at one point, the number two podcast in Slovakia. Which was exciting. Road trip though. Today, we're on the road. We're going back to Aberdeen. We should have been in Aberdeen end of October for Halloween hijinks, but of course, because of Storm Babette, that wasn't happening. And then